ShawTV is proud to present coverage of the 2017 convention for the Association of Vancouver Island and Coastal Communities. I'm Mary Ruth Harris, and we are going to hear first from the host city's mayor from Campbell River, Mr. Andy Adams.
Well, here we are at the 2017 AVICC conference. This is just absolutely fantastic to have everybody here. It's been 15 years, 2002, since the AVICC was here in Campbell River. And when the announcement was made for us to host, the phone was ringing off the hook, the text messages, everybody saying, where should I stay? Where's a good place? Where's something unique? Can't wait to come up there. Haven't been there for a long, long time. So to have the amount of delegates sign up and be here is fantastic.
Marine response to oil spills and emergencies in coastal communities is crucial. Here's what the delegates had to say.
We'll play whatever role we need to in the event of an oil spill. Our coasts are our most precious resource. Our natural environment is our most precious resource in Victoria. It's tied not only to our well-being and quality of life, but our economy depends on the ocean. Not that we're fisher people, but tourism is our second industry, and people come to see the beautiful city. So, should there be an oil spill, our response, emergency response team will do everything that it possibly can. Right now, are we prepared? No. And that's where we're really looking to this ocean protections plan that the federal government has announced to bolster our local response and really make sure that in the event of any marine disaster, the federal response and provincial response and local response are coordinated and are more than adequate.
District of Seychelles in particular, and Gibson's as well on the lower Sunshine Coast, are quite clear in our views that the current marine response is not adequate whatsoever. Once you get outside of Vancouver Harbour, where the marine response is within 6 to 8 hours, an adequate response under current regulations is 48 hours to get to where we are. So we had a resolution at last year's AVICC that was responding to that. It's simply ridiculous. And we saw what happened on the Central Coast. It's actually the same for us, and we're only 40 minutes by ferry away from Vancouver, Horseshoe Bay. So we're actually in an area that has quite a bit of traffic. We have Panamex steamships coming right into Seychelles to get gravel from the largest aggregate mine in North America, which is run by the Seychelles Nation, the First Nations. So we do have boats coming through there, and if any one of those tugs or those Panamex vehicles had trouble, a 48-hour response wouldn't work. Now, they'll be there quicker than that. They'll be there in 10 to 12 or 14, but their regulations says, oh no, it's outside of Vancouver port, 48 hours is good. That's not good.
We do have a Coast Guard in Pell River, and I think that they would probably be the first organization on the scene, but we don't have any oil spill response equipment, and there aren't any operations nearby. It's would probably come from Vancouver, and depending on the weather, it could take a lot of time. And it's interesting that this workshop is 2 years almost to the day to the oil spill in the Burrard Inlet, which was almost 2 hours before there was a response, and that's in Burrard Inlet. So I have to say, there has been an independent report on the spill, which is excellent, and there's some excellent recommendations. And it sounds like they've been enacted in a lot of ways, especially regarding communication and all that, which was a key factor in why the response time was so long in the Burrard Inlet. But I think that coming up to Pell River is going to be it's going to be massive. It'll be hours and hours before there's any kind of response. So that's a big concern.
And that recent spill on the mid-coast in the Bella Bella area was responded to in big part out of Port Hardy because of the fact that we have an airport and we are sort of the hub of transportation services on the North Island. So it's my understanding that we are going to get some marine response capability in Port Hardy and in not too long a time. And I think that's long overdue. It's time to have a response in the mid-coast, which is a lot bigger than people think. Like, it's just not thought of in the way that the actual physical coast is from Port Hardy to Prince Rupert. There might be 5,000 people there, and it's half of our coastline. So we're the place that's got access to that. We have the infrastructure there to allow that to happen. We're very pleased to see Coast Guards working on that for us.
I think everybody on Vancouver Island is extremely pleased of the decision that the federal Liberal government and Prime Minister Trudeau has done to make a commitment to reinvest in the safety of our coast. So to reinstate the Coast Guard station in Comox is critical for the inside of east coast of Vancouver Island, northern Vancouver Island. And we are also working with the Campbell River Harbor Authority on improvements to our Campbell River Coast Guard base here as well. So that's nothing but good news.
In the province of British Columbia, forestry is a major industry. The coastal communities on Vancouver Island and the Sunshine Coast have all developed their own forestry practices and sustainability.
The foundation of forestry is built on sustainability. The legislation and regulations that we have in British Columbia are world-class, world-leading. And in those regulations and legislation, we're required to manage for a full range of resources. So not only do we manage for timber production, we manage for biodiversity, wildlife habitat, water, biodiversity, recreation, tourism, all of those kinds of things. Our forest planners operate on a 250-year time horizon, and then take that 250-year time horizon and break it down into usually decade-long long planning periods, sometimes 20-year periods. And so as we go into areas where we're operating, we have a plan that looks at that long horizon, but also looks at the shorter term and what kind of activity will go on in a watershed or an area over the next 5 to 10 years.
The Association of Vancouver Island Coastal Communities, which is our organization, and the forest companies have signed a memorandum of agreement. And really what that is, it's a communications agreement, because virtually every municipality are not like us. We don't own their own forest, but we're a forest-dependent community. There has been this discussion of, should we be cutting old growth? Should logging trucks be going up and down our highways? This sort of thing. So that's the one side of it. And yet our communities are so dependent on forestry, and it's the other side. And society's changing, and we're asking the question, should we be knocking down these trees? Is the rate of harvest, is that a sustainable one? So there's a lot of debate about this. So this MOU, and that's why I call it, is a communication one. So it's to form a committee and how we can hear both sides and maybe cool down the debate and get to understand all sides of the forestry issue. And that's what the memorandum. So now there's going to be a group that get together and say, how can we deal with these issues? What are the approaches? Maybe we can educate each other, talk a little more. So I see the value in it. So that's why I call it more communications. There is no instant resolution to these problems.
What needs to be known is that forest sustainability in the North Island, for example, means a lot more than it does, for example, in the South Island, and we recognize that. And we recognize that the emphasis, for example, on the lower part of the island isn't so much on forest sustainability and forestry jobs. Obviously, communities like Victoria, Nanaimo, and the bigger communities have moved on to other things. However, we are still very much resource-based and very much dependent on our forest industry. So it's very important to the people of the North Island, the workers on the North Island, that we have a well-thought-out, well-planned forestry industry that's sustainable.
Well, forestry is really important to the Sunshine Coast and Seashelt in particular in a number of ways. So we have a direct role in the sense that we have a community forest that the District of Seashelt actually owns and operates, so we're in the business. But it's also a really important industry and sector for our whole community. both in the sense that we have very, very strong environmental standards and values. We're quite close to Vancouver, and we've got those standards as well. But also important in the sense that Howe Sound, which is our bordering water to the south, is a hub for the entire coastal forest industry. We get logs going through Howe Sound that start as north of Prince Rupert, all through Haida Gwaii down Vancouver Island, and there's log sorts and booming grounds in Howe Sound, which make us a hub. So we're aware of the importance of forestry, plus we have those urbanized environmental standards and values that make it a contested terrain. So as mayor, we get involved in all sides of that.
Forestry is a huge driver of our economy, and we truly believe that there's a way to do forestry that is in a sustainable, environmentally conscious manner. And I think when you take a look at what Dallas Smith was able to do with the Great Bear Rainforest, it took 11 years to come to a compromise. And that compromise means now that we have certainty for protected areas for our environmental sensitive areas, but we also have areas that there is certainty for the manufacturer for harvesting that maintains that employment. And they complement each other. While there is conflict in the news media, there is actually complement between the environment and the resource sector in the woods. Because you've got areas that you have natural fall down, you have snags, you have areas that create dangerous situations for people that are doing recreational use in those areas. So if you clear all of that and keep the area safer, you just provide an opportunity for jobs, economy, while maintaining that pristine environment for the tourist industry and expansion as well.
Well, we're incredibly lucky. We have a quarter of our 81 square miles in a municipal forest reserve. So it's a working forest. It's a forest that we use for recreational values as well. We have a lot of fantastic trails because that land is all mountaintops. Mm-hmm. So we have, we're managing for all these different values. Some areas are conserved. We don't actually log at all. And we realize there are environmental values. For instance, we have ecological reserves within that forest reserve. So we believe that we maintain the forest to a high level. We have a high level of brushing and spacing and thinning and fertilizing in some cases and replacing species like where we have root rot, we're planting white pine instead of fir or hemlock. So we're managing, I would say, quite intensely because it's so much a part of our greater community. So we manage for viewscapes as well. And it's all within our control because we own it fee simple. And that's a huge difference between what we can do and what other areas can do with community forests.
And now we are going to hear from delegates about derelict vessels and how they are impacting the local communities.
We just attended the workshop on derelict boats and marine response. So how has Denman Island been handling that?
With great difficulty. Because we don't have a marina, we don't have a huge problem with that, but we did have a few actually over the winter derelict vessels or shipwrecks you could call them, and it was very complicated. It was hard to know who was in charge and who to call. There was a real desire on the community to get right out there and do something about it just on a community level, but there's liability and safety concerns about that and cost concerns, and it did end up being a grassroots effort to get those dealt with.
The issue that's resonated for me as a councillor in the District of Saanich has been the issue of derelict vessels. In Saanich, we're a larger municipality, so we have had the financial wherewithal to remove some derelict boats. But that's not really fair and not a good system where you have smaller communities for whom a significant amount of their budget could be taken up with derelict boat vessels. That's why it's important that the AVICC and through the upper body, so to speak, the UBCM, also keeps to pressure the federal government, whose responsibility it is for coastlines, to come up with a program. It's been promised in the federal government's recent budget, but we're yet to see that turn into an action, and we're not going to be able to just have the status quo of municipalities that can afford it doing it and municipalities that cannot not doing it.
The Prime Minister announced the $1 billion ocean investment ocean protection program, and hopefully abandoned and derelict vessels will be part of that, because right now it's us that's moving them out at a local cost.
That must really impact your bottom line.
Yeah, it does. It impacts our bottom line. You know, we are all coastal municipalities here at the AVICC. It's a problem not just in Greater Victoria, but across all of the coasts. And it's the federal government's responsibility to help us out. We've got roads and sewers and bridges and parks. Derelict vessels are not part of our mandate.
In North Couchin, we have a lot of coastline. We've had derelict vessels in Chemainus, in Crofton, in Maple Bay, and we're very familiar. We have part of Cowichan Bay, and of course there have been huge issues there. So derelict vessels are an ongoing and very serious concern. And because of the multi-jurisdictional issues and the costs involved, and therefore senior levels of government have been slow to step in or step up, it continues to be a high priority item for us to make sure that someone is responsible and that they are actively working on the problem. And I would say Washington State is probably a leader in this regard, and they've established funding that is available for handling derelict vessels. There are limits to our authority in that jurisdiction and whether we can touch a boat that is still floating. So, and of course, if you let it sink, your problem is compounded. You may not be able to prevent environmental damage. So there are a lot of issues around it, and a clear-cut definition of who's responsible and therefore funding being put aside. And of course, there's a huge number of boats and people abandon them because it's expensive to dispose of them properly. Unfortunately, it comes down to people's irresponsibility. And that extends from small boats to large boats. Cowichan Bay had a couple of very large boats that were just left on moorage, and you could see that eventually they were going to go down.
Yeah, derelict vessels have been an issue in Port Hardy and I think every other coastal community for a long time. And they basically sit in your harbor and use up space and don't pay rent. So at some point, you have to pull them out and get them out of there. And that's what we've been doing over the years, slowly but surely getting them one by one out of the harbor. Well, at the moment, we're doing it at our own cost. We're a bit of an independent community, but it's always a good thing when we get help from the federal and provincial governments, and it's good to see them putting some energy into this problem because it's been one for a long time.
Well, we've experienced two here in Campbell River in the last couple of years, where we had sunken, abandoned vessels in our estuary, which has a huge potential impact with either diesel or gasoline on what is one of the best salmon spawning rivers on Vancouver Island, and we're caught in this no man's land of what is municipal jurisdiction, what's provincial, and what's federal. So it's providing that clarity on a federal basis of derelict vessels. Also, growing up in Victoria and going down the Gorge Waterway, you just Mayor Helps and Mayor Desjardins are having to deal with that issue down there. So everybody is dealing with it in one form or another, and providing that clarity as a unified voice on behalf of AVICC, I think will help find a resolution to the issue.
I thought the workshop was excellent. It was full of a lot of good information, and it's nice to hear from other municipalities and towns having the same problems that Alert Bay is. Communities all up and down the coast are having the same issue with abandoned and derelict vessels. What I learned today was there is funding available if you know the right steps to go through to get access to the funds to deal with some of these derelict and abandoned vessels. We just recently had to deal with an abandoned vessel, and it was the municipality itself that had to foot the bill for dealing with this vessel, and so the taxpayers of the municipality unfortunately had to foot the bill for it. And now we find out that there is money available through the federal government and finding the proper steps to go through to apply for the funds, which is going to be a great help to all the communities all across Canada that has coastline and vessels that are abandoned and derelict.
Here at the 2017 convention for the Association of Vancouver Island and Coastal Communities, one of the keynote speakers was addressing climate change in the form of the transformation of energy policies. Here is what the delegates had to share.
We have a very aggressive climate action reboot underway right now. We've declared that by 2050 we're going to be 100% renewable, and we will have reduced our greenhouse gas emissions 80% from 2007 levels. So it's in line with the climate action targets coming out of Paris. But we're looking under every rock. We're looking at what is the low-hanging fruit, so what do we do first? We're converting our fleet to electric. We're getting our staff on electric bicycles. There's a whole program. We'll be rolling out the details of it this June. Our climate action reboot is really meant to inspire citizens and the community at the same time as look at our own corporate practices.
So we have been encouraging, mostly through education and example. We've just, at the regional district level, done a demonstration project at our transfer station, covered an outbuilding with solar panels, and you know, we have a monitor that shows them the production of energy, and we'll have all the statistics to go with that. So we're just trying to educate people on that. Beyond that, we've talked about district energy systems and biomass and so on. I would say we haven't made a huge lot of progress on that, although the school district at Lake Cowichan did a fantastic biomass project to replace an old oil heating system at their high school with a biomass heating system. And that was brilliant because, of course, the oil burnt was one of our largest, the school district's largest greenhouse gas emissions creator in their entire system. And that was replaced with renewable energy overnight. And it was the payback, they got a grant to help them do it. And the payback was within a few years because of the savings, because oil is not cheap.
We have a very good sustainability plan that was put together in 2010, so it's getting to be about 6 years old. But we've adopted a number of measures in that sustainability plan. One of the really major illustrations of that is a wastewater system that was put in place only 3 years ago, and it's called a water resource center. We take the entire black stream, the sewage stream, and out on the other end comes potable water that is actually it's not being used for drinking yet. The community has some resistance, but it's going in as third high level of treatment. So that's quite good. That particular unit has solar paneling on the roof to add to its sustainability and to its green. In a long time ago, 20 years ago, 1996, our new courthouse and police station was built with a green roof. So we had grasses and things growing on the green roof long before it was more popular in other areas.
As you know, we've got a billion-dollar John Hart Dam hydro-generating project, and that's just replacing and upgrading for so that we'll have that sustainable hydroelectricity power coming from Campbell River for the next 50, 60 years. Campbell River also did a green roof, was the first in BC to have a green roof on their City Hall building. And that was done 11 years ago under Mayor MacDonnell at that particular time. We also have created a Campbell River Community Energy and Efficiency Plan. And part of that is we've also put in our new home construction bylaws, and we did this 7 years ago, that every new home construction had to be solar hot water ready. So every home since that time has been built with a conduit running in so that you could put solar panels on the roof that would come down and have a place to accommodate a hot water storage tank that goes side by side to your existing one so that you've got that augmented power. Solar power, we're getting there. We've been working with OREG, which is the Ocean Renewable Energy Group, and we have Avicc doing their turbines right now underneath the pier that are measuring as to what opportunities there may be for tidal power. So I think we're on the right track. There's a lot more to go, but we're working on it.
Next year's AVICC convention for 2018 will be held in Victoria. Here is Mayor Lisa Helps.
Well, we are very used to welcoming the world in Victoria, so I can't say whether preparations are underway already for next year's conference, but we certainly look forward to hosting it. I can't remember the last time the AVICC convention was in Victoria, so really looking forward to welcoming my colleagues from across the island and the coasts to Victoria. People can bring their bikes. Some of the bike lanes will be up by then. It's a pleasure to work with the AVICC staff and executive to create an exciting program next year in Victoria.
It has been our pleasure to bring you coverage of the Association of Vancouver Island and Coastal Communities 2017 convention from Campbell River. Thank you so much for joining us.